Brock.
I add my congratulations to the leader for her role at the coronation. Commendable upper body strength on show there, and with the added strain of having to remain silent virtually all afternoon. So well done, her. Now, maybe, though, it was a speak softly and carry a big sword moment, as it appears carrying a lethal weapon and wearing an imperial-style outfit now makes her favourite to be the next Tory leader. Was it the sword of Damocles she was clutching? I'm minded of that old Monty Python skit, though, something about strange women distributing swords being no basis for a system of government. But did the leader's somewhat authoritarian look on Saturday reflect the new and unnerving Braverman law, which apparently allows for arresting people even for thinking about protesting? Yeah. So can we have a debate on the thought police and on whether guidance for that a hastily delivered act might be tightened up after those recent unfortunate arrests? Now, speaking of horrible bills, I see Labour, despite the urging of the Archbishop of Canterbury, continues to cleave to this government's nasty, hostile environment policies. Is it any wonder, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that Labour seemingly can't, even after 13 years of the most incompetent, chaotic series of Tory governments there perhaps has ever been, still can't apparently win an outright majority? Yet Labour claims they won't entertain the idea of cooperation agreements with the SNP, despite the fact we will speak to anyone progressive to lock the Tories out of number 10. The thing is, Mr. Deputy Speaker, if we had a fair electoral system, parties would often have to work in partnership with each other, as they do in many other grown-up democracies across the world. So can we have a debate on proportional representation and fair voting, so we can ask why it is the Tories and Labour parties support the antiquated first-past-the-post system that prolongs the establishment duopoly we see year after dreary year in this place? Oops, I believe I've answered my own question there, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Probably just as well, because although we all enjoyed, really, the Leader of the House's starring role at the weekend, I would once again gently remind her her day job is to answer for the conduct of her own government, not simply give her view on the governments of other countries for use on social media. If she could stick to the day job in this, I'd be very grateful.
Yeah. That's
horrendous.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Well, can I first of all thank the Honourable Lady for her compliments, and to say it is good to see her back in her place. I'm very aware that my most successful role in my career to date has been when I have been silent, and that has not been lost on me. She raises the issue of protests, and I would just say to all members of this House, we make the laws in this place, and we have brought in new measures because we felt that the public need protection from particularly disruptive and dangerous protests, as we've seen in recent events and developments. But the police are operationally independent. They need to use their judgment. Sometimes they will make mistakes, and when they do, as we have seen, they apologise for them. And I think all of that is incredibly reassuring, and I'd like to place on record my thanks to the police for the very difficult jobs that they have done in recent weeks, and particularly those that have been standing for a considerably longer period than 51 minutes. I think there was a police officer involved in the coronation who was on a 13-hour shift who I met on their feet for 13 hours. They do a tremendous job, and we owe them a huge debt of thanks. It is no surprise that she should take objection to the result of another referendum that we had on voting systems. No surprise at all. But I am delighted that the SNP, and genuinely delighted, that they have found some auditors. With nearly 2,000 accountancy and auditing firms in Scotland, I was interested as to who they would pick to do the job. Perhaps someone from the Honourable Lady's constituency, given that Edinburgh is Europe's second largest financial centre, second only to the City of London. Yet the SNP have had to go to Manchester in order to find someone willing to take on the task. Presumably the Honourable Lady would view this as offshoring. Perhaps now they could turn their attention to their dire mishandling of Scottish finances and the recommendations of Audit Scotland. I remind this House that the SNP have been forced to raise income tax after a £100 million budget overspend, despite cutting public expenditure by £1.2 billion this year. The Scottish people deserve better than that. And I know that she and her colleagues did not necessarily celebrate the coronation, but I would just say that they can learn a lesson from it. You can't achieve anything with division and hate. The only way forward is service, duty and love.
The Lady of the Lake, her arm clad in the purest shimmering samite, held aloft Excalibur from the bosom of the water, signifying by divine providence that I, Arthur, was to carry Excalibur. That is why I'm your king.
Listen, strange women lying in ponds distributing swords is no basis for a system of government. Supreme executive power derives from a mandate from the masses, not from some farcical aquatic ceremony.
Be quiet!
But you can't expect to wield supreme executive power just because some watery tart threw a sword at you.
Shut up!
I mean, if I went round saying I was an emperor just because some moistened bint had lobbed a scimitar at me, they'd put me away.
Shut up! Will you shut up?
Ah, now we see the violence inherent in the system.
Shut up!
Oh, come and see the violence inherent in the system! Help! Help! I'm being repressed!
Bloody peasant!
Oh, what a giveaway. Did you hear that? Did you hear that, eh? That's what I'm on about. Did you see him repressing me? You saw it, didn't you?